Regulating Appearance in the Work Environment by Abby Price Berry. Nowhere in the country is there such a relationship between the VA and the Navy, said Representative Mark Kirk, who championed the merger of the two Chicago area healthcare facilities. Cooperation between the two ensures the survival of veterans' health care in northern Illinois, while upgrading care for the men and women serving in the Navy. In 2003, the Navy and the VA merged together to form one unified healthcare system. It was their hope that by merging civilians and DOD together, that it would increase the quality of healthcare for active duty, their families, and veterans. It is a work in progress, and there are still many things to sort out. One of the things that I'm going to be focusing on is the dress code. When you put military and civilians together, conflicts about appearance arise. It is my hope to try to implement a dress code policy for everyone to follow in order to promote an equal work environment for all staff. My position on this issue is that not establishing a dress code can create problems that can become greater issues in the future. Not establishing a strict dress code can create an increased risk for hospital-acquired infections, result in employees not properly following infection control protocols, a decreased productivity among staff, and a lack of a professional image. Not portraying a professional image can cause decreased patient satisfaction. The goal is to provide more quality care for the DOD, their families, and veterans. By establishing a dress code, the quality of care will increase. According to an article written by Timothy J. Wood called Exploring the Role of First Impressions in Raider-Based Assessments, first impressions are an important aspect of business. People decide whether or not they like you or want to do business with you within 10 seconds of meeting you. Appearance portrays many different aspects of your character, business, and professionalism. If the first thing a patient sees is your appearance, wouldn't you want them to start their experience off with a positive image of you? The patient will have more confidence in your ability to provide care and give them a more positive experience overall. Which do you prefer? These pictures show the same person in different attire. Which would you prefer in a healthcare environment? Sure, the girl looks okay with her hair down, but which presents a more professional appearance? Obviously, the male in the photo looks more like a professional wearing the lab coat and properly covering the tattoos. Something as simple as appropriate attire can make a huge difference right from the start. Regulating appearance in the healthcare environment by implementing a dress code and having certain requirements based exclusively on appearance will improve the facility by increasing the productivity among staff, increasing patient satisfaction and confidence, and maintaining a professional image that will exemplify quality healthcare for every patient. Employees in the current facility that I work in have enjoyed stretching the rules a little bit too much. I can't completely blame them because when rules are not being enforced, it can have a negative impact on many different aspects of the work environment. I've seen people wearing their hair down and in their face during patient care, coming to work with tattoos exposed down their arms, wearing open-toed shoes, unnatural hair colors, fingernails that are way too long, texting on their phones during patient care, not wearing their identification tags appropriately, and it's becoming obvious that employees are becoming complacent because a policy is not being enforced. After interviewing my boss, Dr. Redloff, I learned that there has not been a strict dress code formed in this facility at all. He said that he felt each clinic supervisor in the VA should just form a dress code for their own staff to follow. After asking him his thoughts on some of my ideas for implementing a dress code, he told me that he would type up a short, concise summary of some of the things he feels the employees should already know. It is hard to establish a dress code when the DOD regulations are so strict. He runs into problems with the civilian staff because they feel they shouldn't have to abide by DOD dress code rules because they didn't sign up to be active duty. While he agrees and sees their side on the issue, he also admitted that it looks unprofessional to have civilians be able to wear whatever they want and the DOD personnel to be dressed in such a professional manner. Not all civilians break the rules, but when one or two do not come to work appearing professional, he runs into problems because a dress code has never fully been established. Here are just some of the pictures to show you the variety of appearances I see every day at work. I know this might be a little bit tough to read, but this is just the short, concise summary of what Dr. Redloff decided to type up for me. This is not the official dress code for the clinic. We do not have a dress code currently. But as he stated, although there is not a formal written dress code for this clinic, here are some general professional guidelines that should be followed. First, for professional and infection control purposes, no open-toed footwear should be worn in the clinic. Tennis shoes or athletic shoes are preferable. Secondly, to keep up a professional appearance for staff members, no tank tops or bare shoulder type apparel should be worn. And thirdly, for professional and infection control purposes, excessively long fake fingernails and large earrings are discouraged. Fourthly, during patient treatment, the wearing of scrubs is highly encouraged, and wearing of the appropriate personal protective equipment is required. The only time the word required was used was when he stated that the appropriate personal protective equipment should be worn. In all the other statements, it says discouraged, encouraged, preferable. In my opinion, when you form a dress code, you can't use words that offer an option. You need to be more concise and more strict and to the point so people know they can't bend the rules. Dr. Redloff feels that employees do not follow the rules because supervisors either get complacent on old policies and start letting things slide, one employee begins breaking the rules and the rest follow, it seems difficult for employees to adjust to changes, rules do not seem to be taken seriously until someone gets fired over breaking them continuously, and the differences in ages seem to pose a problem. He supervises older doctors, young sailors, young civilians, and older civilians. The younger generation has a much more relaxed approach to their view of professionalism, and the older generation gets offended. After interviewing some young coworkers, my boss, my grandmother, there are many conflicting views on how the younger generation perceives a professional image and the way older generations perceive it. My grandmother informed me that if the baby boomers dress in suits and ties, they feel they are viewed as incompetent by the younger millennial generation. On the other hand, my grandmother gets offended when she sees some of the younger generation's appearance in the workplace. The younger generations want a more relaxed dress code and approach in order for them to be able to be more innovative. One conflict that I've personally seen happen at work recently is one younger civilian came to work wearing her nose ring. An older doctor approached her and told her that it looked unprofessional for the healthcare environment and that she should remove it. She rolled her eyes and said no to the older doctor, and so the doctor went to our supervisor. The supervisor asked her to remove it, and she said, "There is no dress code established and nothing that says that she can't wear her nose ring." The next day, four other younger employees came to work wearing their nose rings to make a statement that no dress code has been established and they could do whatever they wanted. This is a problem because there wasn't anything written in the rules that banned nose rings. A survey done by psychologist Jeffrey McGee has proven that a more relaxed dress code actually decreases productivity, makes the company less money, and creates a relaxed mentality. By creating a relaxed mentality, the sense of urgency is destroyed. If in a healthcare environment, a relaxed dress code is acceptable, our productivity will decrease. We are supposed to process 40,000 recruits per year at the VA. These are the recruits that go through boot camp, and in the future, they go into the fleet. We process roughly 1,000 recruits every week. If we keep allowing relaxed appearances, the productivity level is going to decrease. An article written by Sandra L. Colby stated that by 2029, all of the baby boomers will be ages 65 and older. This will comprise more than 20% of the U.S. population. And that's 20% of our population that will be considered a baby boomer. There is going to be a great rise in veterans, and the demand for their care is going to increase dramatically. We have to make sure that we are presenting a professional image for them and strive not to offend their generation by dressing unprofessionally. It is important that we rise up to meet these challenges. The baby boomers will be a large portion of the care given at the VA in many years to come. What they feel looks professional does matter. One study conducted by the University of Chicago proved that patients had more confidence in their doctors who wore a lab coat or scrubs as opposed to a suit and tie. They tested scrubs versus ties and loose clothing and found that higher levels of bacteria lived on the uniform items that are loose and away from the body, such as ties, hair, jewelry, etc. Although they found bacteria on scrubs and lab coats as well, they found more on the loose articles of clothing. The study done by the University of Chicago also found that open-toed shoes pose a higher risk to infection and contamination. Closed-toed shoes protect the skin and feet from sharp objects, harmful bacteria, and hazardous material. They decrease the potential for slipping or injury and decrease the risk for musculoskeletal disorders. Tags have a huge impact on the way patients feel as well. Patients actually reported feeling more safe when they could actually see the ID tag on the person giving them their care. In the picture, I showed that the doctors were orange, the nurses are blue, the LPNs are green. It's important that the patient knows who they're talking to. And in the University of Chicago study, they found that the patients reported feeling more secure in their care and more confident in their care when they could see the ID tag visibly. My boss, Dr. Redloff, he said that in his experience, the best way to implement any new policy is to present it to the staff in a meeting. He stated that it is important to establish a dress code that does not cause discrimination against certain genders or religions. The new dress code policy must also promote safety and infection control. According to Dr. Redloff, an important way to implement this policy would be to have a meeting, like I said, explaining the new policy in depth. Answer any questions the employees may have them sign a paper stating they will follow the new policy, and anyone who does not adhere to the new policy after signing the paper could possibly result in termination. If an employee refuses to sign the paper, further explanation should be given to the person. If they then refuse to comply, they will have to be fired. In his experience, after explaining why a policy is important, employees usually understand the risks and why it should be implemented. He proposed to outline certain consequences like first, send employees home without pay, make them clock out, to change clothes if they don't follow the dress code. Second, he would write a written warning and counseling will be given to the person. And third, an employee would be fired. My ideas from the Navy dress code policy because it actually has a lot to do with infection control and the healthcare environment in many different ways. So I proposed this new dress code, and it states that scrubs will be worn at all times, closed-toed shoes with laces will be worn at all times, ties are not authorized, inappropriate or offensive gang-related tattoos will not be authorized. Tattoos on the head and face will not be authorized. No long sleeves, clothing such as scarves, hats, and jackets will not be worn during patient care. ID tags will be visible at all times. Offensive tattoos will be covered with a bandage. Tattoos that are sexual in nature, discriminate against people based on sex, religion, or ethnicity will not be allowed. I added the religious aspect because I understand that the VA is a very diverse facility, so clothing worn for religious purposes will be on a case-by-case basis and will not interfere with infection control. Different ethnicities propose different challenges with hairstyles. Hairstyles will be determined on a case-by-case basis but will not interfere with infection control. Haircuts and styles should be balanced and not faddish in nature. What I would like to see in our current dress code policy, because the more in depth you go, the less chance you have of running into people who try to bend the rules. So I started with hair. Hair should be pulled out of the face and into a ponytail or bun. This means I don't want to see any loose pieces hanging down. Men should keep their hair neat. Mustaches will be kept neat and should not exceed more than a half inch in length. Women are authorized braids as long as the hair is out of the face and off the shoulders. Unnatural hair colors such as purple, blue, orange, pink are not authorized. Jewelry. Body piercings such as tongue rings, nose rings, eyebrow rings are not acceptable in the healthcare environment. Earrings are not authorized for men. Women may wear one earring per ear. Earrings should not dangle down below the earlobes and should be studs only. Wedding bands are authorized. Necklaces worn for religious purposes are authorized but should not interfere with patient care. Fingernails should be kept neat and clean. Men should keep fingernails clean and should not extend past their fingertips. Women's fingernails should not extend a fourth inch past their fingertip. Mutilation, a split or forked tongue is not acceptable. No foreign object should be inserted into the skin to create a design. No enlarged holes in the ears, intentional burns or scarring on the head, neck, or any part of the body is authorized. Dental ornaments will not be worn. Decorative caps will not be worn. Personal hygiene will be enforced. Designs on the teeth are not authorized. I know this sounds really strict, but when I took the Navy's version of their dress code and thought about the healthcare environment and the professionalism, this just seemed like what any veteran, their family, and DOD personnel, anyone going for patient care would want to see. I propose there should be multiple solutions to this issue. You could still allow creativity for the younger generation by enabling them to choose their own scrubs. Let them pick a cool design, you know, or have the holidays, you know, let them theme their scrubs for the holidays. Let them wear pink tennis shoes if they want to. You know, there's a ways to allow people to be creative without interfering with infection control. You could have a patient compliment box and keep a record of patient compliments after implementing the dress code. Give incentives for employees with the most compliments. After seeing all of my evidence that supports why dress codes are important to implement in a healthcare environment, I came to the conclusion that implementing this strict dress code will reduce the risk of hospital-acquired infections, promote better infection control, increase productivity among staff, increase patient satisfaction, and present a professional image. Dr. Redloff stressed in his interview that it is important to make sure every employee understands any policy being enforced. He said he would be the one to hold the meeting in order to propose these new policies to the staff, but that it is important for any supervisor to stress why and the importance of the policy being enforced. When employees know the reason and see the evidence behind why a policy is being implemented, they are more likely to comply. Make sure they sign paperwork agreeing to comply, make sure to give proper counsel to the employees who refuse to comply, and give the employees adequate time to make these changes. It is important to set goals and set a time limit for them. In the book, Organizational Behavior Theory and Design in Healthcare, the Newsom's 9 C's stuck out to me. Criteria: did you effectively show all the requirements of the new dress code? Did you give feedback to employees if they did not understand or had questions? Consistency: do all the workers receive the same regulations? Is everyone being treated equally? This is important because, as of right now, the Navy has different regulations and the VA has different regulations. Civilians and Navy personnel come to work looking completely different, and there's different expectations for each section. So consistency to me seemed like a huge, huge portion of this. And when implementing the new dress code, you have to make sure all the workers receive the same regulations and that everyone's being treated equally. Communication. Did management effectively communicate this new policy, and do employees understand it? Did you set an appropriate, obtainable goal for your employees to follow? Will employees stay committed to this goal, and how will you ensure that they do stay committed? Was an action plan established for implementing this dress code, and how will you deal with the employees who do not comply? Did you encourage employee feedback? Communication is vital, and it is important to understand your employees and their feelings. What do they think about this new dress code? Are there any aspects of this dress code that they feel need to be changed? Will your employees associate this new dress code with positive rewards? Make sure you show them the change in patient satisfaction and patient feedback in order to give them motivation to continue quality care by presenting a professional image in the future. Did you make undesirable behavior clear to all of your employees? Did this policy work? Re-examine it in 6 months. Compare the patient numbers before, the number of days missed by employees before and after, the number of patient complaints before and after, in order to see the positive change over time and be able to visibly show your employees the positive work they are doing.